Right. Good morning, DrupalCon. How's everybody doing today? Good?
Oh, okay. That was a little bit like 9 a.m. feels right now. Can we get everybody to shout DrupalCon?
DrupalCon! One more time. DrupalCon!
Woo! Okay. Thank you all so much for being here so friendly. This is Super Slip from Decoupled Drupal practitioner. It's going to be a little bit of a fun session for me because it's a little bit of an exploration and of some of the really cool projects that have come about in the Decoupled Drupal ecosystem. But for one reason or another, I've gotten a little bit less air time. But if I was taking DrupalCon or a blog post or the web, I'm going to try my best to use as much time as possible for questions at the end. But if you want to get a hold of me afterwards or talk afterwards, I'll be available to talk about this room and also to get feedback later this morning.
Who am I? My name is Preston. I am the principal product manager at GraphQL. Many of you may know me as the author of a book called Decoupled Drupal in Practice. I've been working in Drupal for about 12 years. First of all, what is GraphQL? GraphQL is a modern web framework that is really great for building extremely fast websites without needing to become a performance expert. One of the things that we like to say in the GraphQL world is that moving part of GraphQL to build a slow website is really easy to fast website. We have great class support for Drupal. Please come on down and say hi to our team. We've got 5 of our team members here today. Second of all, I've got a book out right now. If you are interested in the presentation, actually, a lot of this content is available in the book. As a matter of fact, if you are interested in this topic, covered within the book, Decoupled Drupal in Practice, a really interesting book that many people find useful. Yes, I run a conference in New York City with an awesome team of folks called Decoupled Drupal. Decoupled Drupal is the open conference dedicated to Decoupled Drupal architectures, as well as the future of Catalyst and Decoupled CMS 15 package. So really interesting to you. Please come on down to New York City July 17th and 18th. It's also papers open until June 3rd. We've actually set that. And if you're interested in a sponsorship, we still have sponsorships available as well. Please follow Decoupled at Decoupled Drupal on Twitter for our tickets. All right, so here's the window of our agenda. First thing I want to do is, for those of you who have not been exposed much to Decoupled Drupal, I could give a really quick and then I want to talk about several projects that have really gotten a whole lot of airtime in the community. First is also the API solution, most of the services, also some of the modules that are available that extend the functionality to the important part of the API module, guiding people for as they got started. I'm also going to talk about JSON, might be a module you might want to put in, as well as some of the other projects that are implemented to a lot of the Decoupled Drupal projects that are coming up today. It's like Gemini and OpenGL, this last thing I'll talk about very briefly is a very interesting topic called contextual data. And then finally, I'll talk very briefly about what you can expect with this upcoming release this week coming out next month, the trends that we cover, and what it means for you and your professors today. But first, it's going to be a session that will hopefully give you some insight into some of the things that you might never talk about in a different project with your fellow Drupal developers today. Nobody might have heard of that. All right, so by the way, in the top right of these slides, I've got a reference to chapters in the book where you can find more information about any of these topics if you are interested. Please find a copy of the book and something else is in there. So, very briefly, we all know exactly what monolithic Drupal is. It's kind of the normal Drupal that we use on a day-to-day basis that still lives right now. We have a Drupal site, powered by Flurry, we have kittens, very, very typical of Drupal where how we can work with Drupal. But Decoupled Drupal is very different. Decoupled Drupal is is separation of the software architecture standpoint. Before you add that, we're actually in the past to provide all the file concerns and try to wrap things to a piece of code. We're actually offloading all the file implementation of the study cosmetic concerns over to a consumer application that is actually going to do all of the stuff covered, all of the program coming, all of the stuff. Now, what's been happening quite a bit over the last several years is what's called the JavaScript response. And one of the things that really influenced this progression of events is Node.js, which is the server side of JavaScript, framework that's available, as well as the advent of server side execution of JavaScript frameworks. One of the things that really surfaced over the last couple of years is the notion that nowadays you actually don't really need to have people talk at the time. One of the things that is interesting is the fact that universal JavaScript, the idea of having shared code across the client, also called isomorphic JavaScript, is very important for that revolutionizes the way that people learn JavaScript these days. And as a result, it is something that has to be also because of the community. So, what does this kind of architecture look like in Drupal? Well, if you are executing a server side framework, like a Node React or whatever, on the Node server, what that process does is actually perform whatever request that you have just given to Drupal, and then it comes back with a response, which is then sliced out to the browser, and then bound once again to the document that's provided by the client that is using that document as the framework. Once that is complete, all of those asynchronous events that happen as a result of that is that from the wire that you need to provide for the client side. So there's a couple of risks and rewards that you want to keep in mind. Obviously, there's architectural considerations that we're still concerned about, but you might use some of the right to set setting or layout management to execute what you want to do. The whole experience, there's this concept called pipeline development, which allows for teams that are working on the plan and backend concerns to not block one another. But there's also the issue of having two separate code bases. But one of the really interesting things that I've seen is that this over the last several months, it's not going to be better than the next one. It's a single repository compiles both your Drupal site and, for example, a Jasper site. Security performance, you can actually tie to CMS behind the computer and the disruptive security because of the fact that the main access point that's your decoupled consumer rather than your actual CMS slash user and so forth. But that also means you might have a number of points there. Cognitive device, there's a lot of things that you might want to consider. Stacking Drupal projects that are monolithic is becoming a little bit more attractive. It's hard to find the developers, hard to find the developers. It's very easy to talk and craft developers, very easy to find the developers. But there's a whole lot of onboard that are never possible because you actually have to train all of the people how to become a Drupal operator and also find the plan to do that as well. Last night, I was hanging out with some of the Gatsby team members, and we were talking about some questions for teams. So I put in some quotes and facts of some of the data examples that we've all stored in classics. So we're about to open the present test to see some of the secrets of the decoupled Drupal ecosystem. Are y'all ready? All right, here we go. So once again, decoupled Drupal is the use of Drupal as a content service for consumer applications. That's the definition that you can keep in your head and you can use it in your code. Let's talk about some of the alternative solutions that are out there. Many of us know about things like REST and CORE, as well as API and GraphQL. But what about this other module that is optimizing but not really delving into our REST web services? It's a module that is maintained by Node.js, and it actually implements the Apache Pipedream specification. One of the really cool things about the Apache Pipedream specification is that it's a server side equivalent of some of the offline first technologies that you might want to use to build offline first enabled websites. There's technologies to make like Cody or TrustDB or something like that. But one of the things that we're going to talk about is actually services that is part of this Drupal ecosystem. So Drupal Here's a diagram of people like services. One of the things that you might not know is that GraphQL is actually not a RESTful service. But RESTful services is a REST API, which means that it can see all of the REST principles as one at one for a building. By the way, a note about submitting code samples is the code voice that might use across the cross my functions. So if you have a REST facility, you can just make a REST reference function with all JSON's going to be yellow. So how to install the REST? Well, if you want to do a composer, it's the REST of the composer requirements. The function that we write in today, the Drupal is all people and all you have to do is the people module, but there is a dependency that you have to account for, and that also get into your decoupled Drupal extension. One of the things that you might want to do is to some specific values. If you want to use it differently, you want to have a bunch of flexible PRs. Also, if you want to do things like process staging, one of the things you'll have to do is include a replicator user with certain services that I have before. That's it, but I don't have time to build it to see the people's core ecosystem that much like them. But check out process services in my website to see more information there. One of the things that's interesting is that there's a concept called workspaces and enterprise web services. And I think in workspaces, one of the really cool things is that you actually have draft versions of content and unpublished content. One of the things that's really interesting about the REST web services is that full flex resources support that can actually get individual resistance of content as well as other content support. That's something that actually takes a very high management quite late in the process. So one example is using a postman. This will be familiar to you. This is a single group of entities that you perform with a request against with things that you have to do to service flex or REST flex while it's provided in the UI of the Drupal game. If you actually need some ideas in Drupal, you can go ahead and post to /relax/1 to the default URL, get that to a one-page response to that, and you want to provide some of these important values. I would love to cover updating one of the really wonderful things about REST web services that you can update the whole page and you can fit in more than that if you still try to do for some of the really good RESTful alternatives if you're looking at something that works in a little bit different from JSON, a little bit different from some of the solutions that are out there. You might want to consider the REST web services, especially if you want to look at pipeline first capabilities over Python staging. All right, let's move on to JSON API. How many of you are using JSON API right now? So JSON API is wonderful. It's one of those amazing modules that but there's a couple of modules. There's one module and a sub-module that actually is very powerful for changing the way that the API behaves. And it might be interesting for those of you who want to improve the experience that you're trying to develop for consuming the stuff on that particular application. Sometimes it's really common that some of the things that we want to get the API are a little bit too easy. You know, we might not necessarily want to have to put it up to a disciplined point that it's going to be added. Also want to override some of the defaults that are provided because it's not considered extensive. So JSON API has apply those default settings and give you certain capabilities to change output of the source system coming out of those applications to the platform. Some of the examples include things like enrich the sequence of the resources that might help with the search forms. You can also use the first resource in the account within that URL as well as the field names that you have contained within that table to come down to the response. Also, you might want to disable certain individual fields because you might want to reduce the size of the payload or the mix of performance and also you might want to modify some of the field guides that people access. It is a series of answers that allows to actually recast the field guide that was coming out into the payload. So how to install these API extras? Well, you can go ahead and start it because you require one of the really interesting things that's happened on the application is that JSON API default is now called somewhat of a JSON API extras. So just by requiring here's how you might want to configure it if you want to change the table that you have that source is located on. These are things that you can do with the JSON source configuration if you want to just provide a JSON API extra. Or you might want to do things like enrich some of the fields. One of the things that we often hear from consumers, from developers of these consumer applications is that you want to be able to have a data. What is it? Very Drupal system is something that I think is something that we all care about, but I think it's important to the things that aren't really capable to get done to the environment. So if you want to give them a little bit more of a document, so that document is essentially what it really works for, you might want to just separate some of those fields. If you get a phone call out of the set, you can call the filters. So for example, if you want to be consumers of yours, you can ask them to request that for a bit less. Without those parameters, you might want to actually provide by default a certain filter or a certain input that is going to always be captured for the network. What about running Drupal remotely? This is one of the coolest aspects of our Drupal system that has come out in the last year or two. By the way, this has been happening for the cloud. So this not just is a very interesting one. Sometimes one of the things that people find, especially as we're building things like Android or APIs or applications that are very richly manipulated with what's going on in Drupal, is that we want to make certain cohesives that are tightly integrated available to some of these consumer applications. Things like performing a cashless checkout or performing orders right across the office. These are things that aren't necessarily RESTful cohesives. So for those who are in the field of RPCs, remote procedure calls are basically executed via procedure or subroutine on another system. And it's actually executing that in room or the system itself, doing some more hiding to force you to call that directly with the underlying system. So RPC in Drupal are very useful for any extra operator that helps you want to represent the rest. If you think about the rest constraints, a lot of the things that I'm talking about, like with the management type of the system, those are non-operations that you can capture within some of those RESTful principles. So this might be to provide a really lightweight, stable protocol for ITC itself on the global computer. It's maintained by a fair amount of Taylor Phil and other big service. These RPCs actually intend to serve as kind of that canonical authoritative foundation for folks who want to be really interested in information on the RESTful side of the computer, not just the time. Now, here's how this works. One of the really interesting things, first of all, to have one is to have the option to install a JSON RPC discovery somewhat. And this might have to find the flag that you need to find through and navigate through what's possible within that JSON RPC module. So, one of the things that you might Actually, we can do things like list some of the design buckets and access to some of the things that have stuff that they want to do for and the And also, there's a route where we can go right there as well in case it's not the same. So the whole wire is the same. One of the really important things that we're having in consumer application today is that many of the product developers who are working with your API on the back end really want to have a solid understanding of those responses work and how they request onboarding from them in your larger portfolio. So one of the things that's really important and is covered in Practitioner 4 and 9.5 is the notion of schemas. For those of you who might not be familiar with those much with some of those terminologies, schemas are basically descriptive really kind of describe how the API works, how you can expect the API to the grid when you're operating with them on your consumer application. So while the module is mentioned by Apple, it provides protective derived schemas that allow for really interesting approaches like the documentation, which I'll talk about shortly, as well as their input. One of the really interesting things that's come about in the API ecosystem, for instance, is the ability to create the schema that outlines how the particular data structure actually allow you to form on the fly suggested forms depending on the fly parameters that actually appear to the actual line to manipulate that because it's very complex to generate an entire fly just by not an answer to a small. So that possibility of having such a model, there's a couple of things you need to enable to the model as well as to find a case to them. And if you want to navigate, that's actually one of the really cool things to do is just do this directly from the module. So if you install it and actually go to the flat article and the parameters, where you can actually get out the street set to how that looks in this new API, that can probably be used to clear up. One of the things that you have to know here is that there is a distinction here, but it's very effective, which is that when you actually consume a JSON API, for instance, so navigating through some of the resources available to the JSON API, you actually have to make sure to put in so that actually means that for things like users, you have to be able to put it in OpenAPI is one of those generated documentation projects that is really interesting. You might have heard of it as one of your own metaphors. It's something that products or web services based on a schema that aligns. So the OpenAPI module integrates with both Flurry and JSON to actually document the schema with the graphs that you might want to access to get those resources in those web services. There's two types of UIs that are available to connect with the cross documentation that's generated with Flurry and schema with JSON Drupal. One of those is flurry, which is really great. The JavaScript library that is used to create that kind of documentation. You can also use this flurry part as well, which is another form of generating documentation based on the schema within the document. Okay, now let's finish up with one quick side note, which is that we've covered a lot of the aspects of a Drupal backend, to come with Drupal backend, that are really interesting to get the amount of infrastructure that needs to be performant, that needs to be configured to be designed. And also that it's really a Google thing to do that right from the first two or three times the JavaScript UI technologies to be used. But what about some of the things that are more architectural or infrastructural considerations that we might want to have on that? One of the most interesting models that's come out of the contemporary ecosystem, how many people have heard of contemporary CMS? Okay, so contemporary CMS is a distribution of people that is optimized for decoupling. One of the projects that exists as part of that contemporary ecosystem is what's called contemporary covered in practice exchanges right now. The contemporary app is a Node.js server practicing that actually acts as middleware between a Drupal API that you're doing open source that you're consuming on one side why is the idea of practicing this form of shape? Well, first of all, by application, for instance, for actually, also, Node.js is a requirement if you want performance on the server-side rendering, which is great for things like accessibility and SEO on the front end. And you can also use it as a factory as well. There's also more information about tracking as well. So any command to CMS easily provides an interface to most of the services, and you can use it for all of the modules to keep up with the ability to take a very space and help this community if you can use any one of the regular places that you figure crossroads and resource kind of workforce, which might be a little bit easier for them to be familiar with how these things work. All right, so finally, before I take questions, what is the next step to decouple people in the system of CMS development? Well, I think one of the things that we find is that many of the APIs before, and we're taking first class concern, and we've got a lot of concern with making it before, decouple people is no longer here, it's no longer a hypothetical, it's no longer something that's just it's something that you can do on your box support. You can actually install a Drupal and include a couple modules and do it on your job. Decoupled Drupal is now in memory. It's just ecosystem is robust, not only robust, but also rapidly expanding. New products coming out every single day. For example, after this last week, there were just coming to Seattle, that Fortnite solution is a decoupled Drupal distribution optimized for JavaScript. So, one of my other favorite things, by the way, is that very common is what you study. I work, the best way to get most of that type of information. I hope you enjoyed this look at the sequence of the couple of people practitioner. For more, let's go and have a sense of the practice. And finally, we're going to spread on Friday, many contributions, first time contributing to the first contribution. Please tell me what you thought about this stuff, and I know it was really short, but I hope you take a look at this connection and we'll talk to you soon. Or next, decouple people present. Thank you very much once again. Thank you to the hashtag and I couple of people secrets if you want to ask some questions. Let's not just find out soon. Once again, chemistry highlight job is the next thing you can do to the pod, speaking to each other. The really is for you to talk to each other about everything around how to converse. We'd love to hear about your experiences. Please consider ordering my book. It's currently available at practitioner.com. I'm able to take orders on the web and print. Please feel free to let me know if you think that it's worth your time. And finally, please join us for a couple days. Thank you very much. Time for maybe one or two questions. So many of us need to use on a regular basis to create those really great first things that you have on Drupal sites. There's a couple of things about these that are important to them. The first is that these does have, as you noted, a graph export display that is available for you to create an API on the fly if it's on the web. However, one of the issues that I actually just found a lot of the core functionality that's available. So, for example, it's not a great whatsoever with JSON. It's not really adhering to a particular standard like that. As a result, actually, one of the things that I came up with Slack, which was Slack, was that some of the apps, both JSON API before actually allocated certain content. And one of the reasons that JSON API was there is that, so the short answer to your question is, these dynamics typically only be used for monolithic Drupal sites. JSON API has much of the same functionality. Obviously, exposed sources for the if you're interested in that, if you're interested in exposed sources, by the way, that's something you can talk about afterwards. But these are not really something that is a sustainable way to use API applications. However, if you're looking for something totally easy, it's a simple get request, that's really easy to do. The more you get used with these graph exports is that you only have that access to, you can't do it right, so Thank you very much. If you would like to talk, I'll be right outside. Also, come and find your stuff again. Thank you.